Howdy, I'm Jim. I'm a huge Transformers fan, and I made this book for Transformers fans. I'm here to talk about why we chose the pieces we did and share some cool stories about how the pieces got made and why we picked them. We spent a lot of time going through what the prints should be. I think early on we decided we wanted to try and feature prints from the various different eras. So we'd have something from the movies, we had something from the comic books. This is a volume that's designed to sit proudly on a bookshelf or on a coffee table. This is one where, you know, you can show off to your friends who aren't Transformers fans and they'll be impressed. Bludgeon, he's a skeletal samurai warrior, which, I mean, how cool is that? I think what's interesting about him as a character is it's this kind of nothing burger character from 1989 where, you know, they were selling him for about $8.99 each and he's one of a three-pack. There's not much going on from a marketing side, but because the creators, especially Simon Furman, who was the Transformers writer of the Marvel comics back in the 80s and early 90s, because he kind of picked up on, you know, how cool it is to have an undead samurai Transformer, you know, this character wound up becoming extremely popular with the fandom because he was one of the leaders in the comics. And I think you can see where Simon was drawing from by looking at some of this artwork. This is Skylynx and Skyrain from the Combiner Wars toy line, which I thought was really cool. So Skylynx has always been a popular character, you know, the egomaniac Autobot space shuttle. But the idea that he could combine into a larger robot, into a Gestalt or a Combiner with other ones in the form of Skyrain is neat. And I like the idea of doing this as a full page spread. So you can see what his base looks like and then what he looks like when he's powered up with four other robots. This is a good example, I think, of the collaborative nature of a project like this, because from a hardcore Transformers perspective, I don't think it would have occurred to me to put Stripes as a full-page spread, not because it's not nice artwork, it's gorgeous artwork, but because he's not an important character. This is a character who was an exclusive to Japan in the 80s, and it was sort of impressive that Hasbro chose to update him in modern times anyway. But then just on the strength of the artwork alone, my editor thought, oh, well, why don't we give him a full page spread? And it works beautifully. With all of this artwork, the artwork tends to be created really large, but then, you know, you have to shrink it down and crop it for the package. So one of the nice things about this book in general, and certainly this piece in particular, is that you get to see the artwork in all of its glory without having, you know, a logo across it and having his foot cut off. This is a really interesting piece because this piece came out in Wizard magazine in the year 2000. And at the time, Transformers was mostly beasts. Beast Wars and Beast Machines was what was going on with the brand. And they hadn't really revisited the classic characters in quite a while. And when Wizard magazine put out this piece, the fan response was amazing, not just from the hardcore Transformers fans, but just from the casual 80s nostalgia fans. And all of a sudden, I think a whole lot of light bulbs went off and people realized, oh, you know, Transformers doesn't have to just continue to evolve in new directions. We don't just have to go from G1 to G2 to Beast Wars to Beast Machines. We can also revisit some of these classic characters and people might emotionally respond to that. And I think this piece was particularly critical in bringing about that revelation. And it was kind of fun for me on this piece in particular because it was such a seminal piece, but nobody had it. Nobody had the artwork. I went to the original creators and they didn't have it in their computer. Wizard magazine didn't really exist anymore, so they didn't have any archives. And we actually wound up putting out all these feelers, and somebody who had been an editor at Wizard back in the day dragged it out of their Hotmail account because somebody had mailed it to someone else, and we managed to get a print quality copy. But that's the sort of sleuthing that went into making this book, and I'm really proud that we were able to find this piece and preserve it so that you don't have to just get an old issue of Wizard off eBay and get one that's tiny. So Transformers number 5 of the Marvel Comics. This was the first issue of Transformers that I ever got. I remember being at the supermarket with my mom and seeing this cover of Transformers. And I liked Transformers, I liked the toys, but I didn't know the comics were a thing at all. And here's Shockwave, and he's standing there. The Transformers are all dead, and if you open the issue, he's killed them all. And in fact, I think the previous page in the book is a two-page spread of him with all the dead bodies of the Autobots. And it just blew me away. So I have so many positive associations with this piece. And it's such an iconic piece. This is probably one of the top 10 pieces of Transformers artwork by recognizability in the world. So it's great to be able to include something that's not just personally relevant, but also is iconic. Windblade's kind of a fun character because she engendered, no pun intended, a bit of fan backlash, I think. She was the result of a fan vote, and you know, they chose this female, Japanese-oriented jet character. And this is a really nice look at, you know, what she looks like with the final design, and the black and white really pops, I think. And it's kind of fun to get some more of the female characters into the book. This is another one of those happy accidents. Beast Wars Uprising was a series that I got to spearhead with the Transformers fan club, and we never really set off to do a specific Beast Wars Uprising two-page spread. We were just trying to showcase the fan club. But again, the designer looked at all the different fan club pieces and wound up making this spread of just Beast Wars Uprising images, and I thought, yeah, let's go with that. Transformers Animated, I love how this two-page spread came out. It showcases all of the different print iterations of the Transformers Animated experience that they came out with. You know, we've got the Transformers All-Spark Almanac, which is a book that I wrote, and that had just a beautiful cover by Marcello Matere. But it also has the Titan Comics, that was a group out of the UK. They did animated comics, we've got a cover from them. We have the IDW Comics. We've got the Return of Blur, which was a radio play that they did that was illustrated, and we've got some of the artwork from that. And we've got the Stunticon Job, which was sort of a season 3.5, they branded it, comic they did for Animated. So it's kind of neat to have every different iteration of Transformers Animated in print right in the book. So this is in our homage section, where we look at the different places where the Transformers has gone and looked at either other brands or sometimes looked back on themselves. And this one is Rob Liefeld doing the classic Rob Liefeld New Mutants number 87 cover. And he went back and he redid that same iconic cover in the form of a Transformers book. So I think it's just so great that not only that exists, but that we're able to showcase it. This one, I was thrilled to be able to get into the book because in 1984, this image was everywhere. This image was on lunch boxes. This image was on posters on walls. I had it on my wall. It was all folded and faded and torn, but I had it on my wall for years. You know, this was the image that they used to promote the Transformers when it first came out. And it just encapsulated everything about those early years of the brand. You know, it's got spaceships shooting at each other. There's a volcano in the picture. It's got the robots. It's got the vehicle modes. It's got everything. And it wasn't something that existed in a high quality format. This is one where we found an old poster, scanned it in, and restored it specifically for the book. So it's great that we're able to preserve this artwork so that we can use it again going forward, because it was such an important piece back in the day. These are fun because you've never seen these before. These were behind the scenes production artwork that got lost for years and years and years. And I managed to track it down from a woman who basically dumpster dives and sells office furniture. And she got filing cabinets from the old Marvel offices, the old Marvel Studios offices back in the day. And then they sat in her warehouse for 10 years. And she reached out and said, I've got Transformers stuff, is there any value to it? So I helped her figure out what all this stuff was. She let me scan all of it from my archives. She sold off the originals, and now we get to bring them to you. And it's especially fun because Orion Pax never transformed in the episode. This got snipped at some point after they storyboarded it, because we never actually see him transform. So you get to see what, you know, Optimus Prime's original vehicle mode looked like for the first time ever. So this is one of the very last images from the Beast Machines television show. I was fortunate enough to get the mainframe archives before the studio went away. And these are the original renders. So these aren't screen captures. These are the original renders that they used. And this is the pretty much the final image of the series. You have Mount Megatron all covered in forests, and then Thrustinator, the Waspinator Thrust hybrid, flying away, ending the series, just like he ended the Beast Wars series. This very busy piece was one that I had a hand in making in the first place. This was from the Transformers GoBots crossover series that we were doing in the fan club back in the day. And we had this idea that wouldn't it be neat if we took all the different GoBots characters and re-rendered them in Hasbro-owned bodies. So each of these is a GoBots character in a Transformers body. And you know, you could probably spend an hour just trying to go through and figure out what all the bodies are, what all the characters are. The other kind of fun thing about this piece is that it could have, instead of going in the crossover section, go in the homage section, because it's done in the style of the Goodbye Megatron, Goodbye Convoy posters that were a pack-in poster in Japan back in the 80s. So it's not just a whole bunch of GoBots, it's also this reference to a really classic Transformers piece. So the Transformers Legend card game was kind of a blessing for us, because the video game section, you know, the early video games can be pretty primitive. You could see, you know, we included screen renders from Commodore 64 games. And they're pretty neat to see how sort of neat and weird and blocky they are. But also, this is an art book. So the Transformers Legends online game gave a chance for us to showcase some really beautiful, more traditional style artwork. And I think Soundwave and Starscream are a really good example of that. And the Starscreams, and this was another one of those pieces where I said, we're a little light on Starscream, maybe we should put a little more Starscream in the book, and hence King Starscream. This is a fun piece. This was the promotional artwork for BotCon 97. It's by an artist named Andrew Wildman, who was one of the big Transformers UK artists back in the day. And they redid the colors and the inks for this book so that we'd have a modern colored version of it. But it's just a great piece. It's got all the Decepticon leaders from the time period playing a game against Optimus and RC. It's kind of fun. So this is one of the most important pieces of Transformers movie artwork that exists. This was the piece that helped Michael Bay crystallize his vision for what the Transformers film should be. And one of the challenges of the piece from a movie production standpoint was they did the piece in portrait. And of course, films are done in landscape. So there was a big challenge on the set to try and take this vertical piece and make it play horizontally on the screen. Oh, I love this one. This is an old sailing ship in the form of a Transformer. I mean, how cool is that? The Transformers movie aesthetic was always about pushing boundaries, about, you know, what can a Transformer be? You know, most of the Transformers brand is focusing on, you know, cars and jets and maybe a dinosaur or a dragon or something. But Michael Bay always seemed to want to do, well, what about a tank? You know, what about a sailing ship? And I think this is just the perfect example of that. I really wanted to be able to try and get the entire history of the Transformers brand in one book. And that's not easy to do. Transformers have been around since 1984. I mean, that's 35 years of content. That's a lot. And you know, they cover film, they cover video games, they cover comic books and animation, and of course they cover toys. And each different medium has its own requirements for what makes a good piece. A good piece of box art is not a good piece of comic art. And, you know, a good piece of movie concept art is not the same as an animation model. And to be able to try and showcase all of that in one volume is incredibly challenging, but also incredibly rewarding. And I don't think I could have done it if they hadn't given me the incredibly generous 400-page count to play with. I think if this was 200 pages, there's no way, it would have been a sketch, you know, but this is not a sketch. This is the real history of the Transformers artwork. Are there things missing? Of course there are. There have to be. You know, in comics alone, you get 22 pages a month per book of high-quality artwork. You can't possibly feature every single piece. But to try and get the most iconic ones, to try and get the most interesting ones, the most representative ones, and then some quirky ones that nobody's ever seen before, or maybe that you've seen before, but not in the context of artwork. You know, you've only ever seen it really teeny tiny, you know, on a box. And, you know, now you can see it as art. You know, all juxtaposed together, it's great.